Before we get started, I'd like to begin with an acknowledgement to country. I'd like to acknowledge and pay respects to the traditional owners of the land on which we meet tonight, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. This land has always been a learning space for many Aboriginal nations, and the Enterprise Sea draws strength and guidance from the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander ways of knowing, being, and doing. So with having said that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Stephane Shepherd. He's completed his BA in Criminology from Monash University in 2005, a Master of Communications in 2007, and his PhD in Forensic Psychology in 2030. His thesis investigated the cross-cultural validity of adolescent violence risk assessment instruments for Australian young offenders in custody. He currently works as a senior research fellow and lecturer at the Center for Forensic Behavioural Science at Swinburne University. In 2015, Stephane was awarded the inaugural 2015 Fulbright postdoc scholarship in Cultural Competence. Come on in. He spent a year in the U.S. working with researchers at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln and UCLA, where he conducted research on cross-cultural violence risk assessment. Stephane has been working and collaborating with the National Center for Cultural Competence since October, so please join me in welcoming Dr. Shepherd.
Thanks very much for that kind introduction, Amy.
Thanks everyone for your attendance. It's really good to be here today. I too want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, the Gadigal people. Thank you for having me on our country today for this presentation. I've got a Creole background and I'm based in Melbourne, Victoria, although I had just spent a very interesting year in the US, in the Midwest. My area is forensic mental health. So for people unaware with that sort of niche area, it is the interface of mental health and the law. And what I tend to do is I look at the methods and measures that psychologists and psychiatrists and other health professionals use when working with people who have contact with the criminal justice system. But what I specifically look at is whether those methods and measures actually extend appropriately or commensurately to people from different ethnic backgrounds. Now today I'm going to cover a bit of terrain, but the point I want to get across today is, I guess, how we can sort of take more of a therapeutic approach in justice health, and how we can do a lot better in meeting the needs of Indigenous people in custody. But I want to undergird my presentation first by talking about crime rates and imprisonment rates. I think that's important, because these concepts are not actually the same thing. They're often talked about as being the same thing. But imprisonment rates refer to how many people are actually locking up. Crime rates refer more to the amount of criminal activity coming to the attention of police. So they're not completely mutually exclusive, but they do tend to fluctuate or work independently of each other. So you might have two states, and I saw this in the US as well, you might have two states with similar crime rates. However, they have completely different imprisonment rates. You might even have one state that has had a stability in their crime rates for some period of time. However, you will see some fluctuation in the imprisonment rate there. So for example, some of you might know in New South Wales recently, there was an interesting report which showed that over the past 15 years, arrests for Indigenous people had actually declined significantly, but imprisonment rates had actually grown. You could also point to Victoria here in the last 10 years, particularly for the 18 to 20-year-old age group. We've seen comparatively stable amount of crime. However, the imprisonment rates have fluctuated as well for that particular group. So what's going on there? Well, I would say that because they're both underpinned by different forces now. This is somewhat simplified, but I would say that crime rates are very much linked to social deprivation and opportunity structures in society. So if you basically go to any jurisdiction and you want to sort of work out what are the postcodes where the prison population comes from, it tends to be the areas that are underprivileged, the areas that are under-resourced, the areas where you'll find intergenerational unemployment and just general adverse surroundings and the possibilities for cumulative negative life events. And around Australia, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders are perhaps disproportionately more likely to be in such areas. And here, with those particular populations, you will have additional cumulative impact, as well as historical trauma in some communities. Now, impoverished areas are generally poorly equipped to deal with the high level of ongoing crises. They're also more likely to produce traumatised individuals who are angry or feel socially alienated or ostracised by the rest of society and therefore highly reactive. And control over one's life in these situations is they're more likely to be diminished, and that ultra-stressful environment can lead to law-breaking behaviour brought to the attention of police. Now, imprisonment rates are different. They're politically determined. And this is where the law and order style politics can make a serious difference. As I mentioned before, if you have two states, hypothetically, one state has more of an emphasis on non-custodial diversionary alternatives, while the other has more of a punitive approach, then we'll probably see difference in sentencing trends and therefore diverging imprisonment patterns. Law and order strategies, as we all know, are also politically popular with the public. However, they are reactionary, they tend to be knee-jerk, and they don't actually address the underlying causes of crime, like social deprivation. So they tend to sweep up a lot of the people who are disconnected or come from precarious living environments. So rather than address the causes and effects of social issues, law and order basically leaves it to the justice system to deal with, which is just frankly untrained to repair social disadvantage. Now, law and order strategies not only serve to embolden imprisonment rates, but they inadvertently sustain social deprivation as well. Now, this is through collateral damage or collateral impact that tough on crime strategies have on communities. So we have people committing crimes in abject social conditions. We lock them up, we release them back into the same environment, except now they're much less employable. They may have toughened inside, they've got hardened attitudes, developed more antisocial attitudes, and they've probably developed a broader criminal peer network. And in the process, they've also lost ties that they may have had in the community as well when they were locked up. So what does that mean for the community? Well, it has that flow-on impact, that flow-on effect of collateral damage. So when you have a community that has citizens who are frequently coming in and out of prison, or correctional transients, if you will, you have an increasingly unstable environment with a diminished capacity for community cohesion. And this can render entire neighbourhoods ineffective at just promoting pro-social behaviour or teaching kids how to avoid delinquent behaviours. Now, these situations can be crime-promoting in and of themselves. And so here we have, you know, law and order strategies can also spill into crime rates as well in other ways through over-policing or differential enforcement in certain communities. Now, for those like myself who work in the justice health profession, this situation can be a little bit overwhelming and a little bit saddening, particularly because, you know, we've got these socio-political forces that I've just described that are seemingly out of our own control, and they deliver us frequently individuals, disproportionately Aboriginal, whose needs have not been met in the community, and now they're expected to be met or managed in custodial settings. And this is made all the more difficult in a tough-on-crime paradigm, where just deserts is preferred over therapeutic initiatives. So it's easy to become defeatist with the knowledge that there are A, not enough alternatives to custody, and B, insufficient attempts to rectify that social disadvantage. But there is a lot we can still do in our capacity as medico-legal professionals and researchers, community members and advocates. And this is what I want to discuss today. So what are the initiatives and attitudes that we can personally hold or consider beyond law and order approaches? So to begin this discussion, I actually want to share with you some of the research, some findings from some of the research I've conducted over the last 18 months. Now, these findings provide some insight into the sort of met needs and unmet needs of Indigenous people in custody and in the community, and indicate the need for alterations in service delivery. So this study, well, the analyses was conducted between 2015 and 2016 by myself as a representative of the Centre for Forensic Behavioural Science, and this was in conjunction with the Koori Justice Unit, Victorian Department of Justice. So the aim here was to identify the met and unmet needs in prison, as well as associations with cultural connection and cultural identity. So we managed to gather a representative sample of 122 of male and female Koori prisoners from 11 different prisons in Victoria. And I'm going to summarise the findings now, which were particularly interesting. Okay, so study one, we discovered that the prison itself, so the prison environment itself in Victoria, seemed to meet the general needs of many Indigenous people in custody. So it provided food, it provided accommodation, provided daytime activities, there was improved self-care, improved safety to self, there was available company for socialising, and also general treatment. There was availability of general treatment needs. Now, most of the sample acknowledged that their needs were being met in those regards. So that was, it was quite a kind of indictment that, you know, those particular needs weren't being met in the community, and it was a sort of an upgrade for a lot of the people that we were interviewing. However, there were two common unmet needs that we found across the sample. Seriously elevated levels of psychological distress, which was ubiquitous in the sample, and also safety to others. So this was putting others in danger around you, not just in custodial environments, but in the community as well. So those needs were unaddressed in prison, indicating that there was probably a lack of therapeutic options to deal with those specific issues, those specific treatment needs. Now, given that the majority of Indigenous offenders in Victoria locked up for violent offences, you'd probably want options inside to deal with things like elevated levels of psychological distress and the capacity to inflict harm on others. So after ascertaining those general and specific or treatment needs, we followed the sample post-release into the community. Now, we found that prisoners who had more unmet needs, they found that they had greater unmet needs in the custodial environment, they were much more likely to offend and offend earlier. Now, those who were the group that did actually go on to re-offend, we found that they were less likely to have their treatment needs unmet in prison. So re-offending here among the Indigenous cohort in Victoria was related to unmet needs in custody. Interestingly, drug use or needs relating to drug use or unmet needs, treatment needs, that was found to be the strongest predictor of violent re-offence. So what do we take from study one? Prison seems to be meeting the non-criminogenic needs, the basic day-to-day health and activity needs, general health. But it's definitely not broadly addressing or reducing needs related to distress, violence to others, and substance use. Those three key unmet needs related to offending. So there's significant gaps here in service delivery. Now, this could mean several things. Either there weren't any, or there just weren't enough programs in prison addressing those concerns for that cohort. Or there are, but not everyone has access to them, and that's not entirely uncommon, having worked in prisons. Or there probably are, but maybe the Indigenous prisoners are not engaging with them for whatever reason. Perhaps the programs aren't culturally appropriate. Okay, so we decided to investigate further by looking at the cultural identity of the sample. And we measured this expediently, but it is a difficult thing to measure. And we used Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander identity scale, a 7-item scale. Now, we took this from a broader social and emotional wellbeing questionnaire, which was created by an advisory group of Aboriginal psychologists for the study. Now, the identity scale included such items such as the importance you afford to culture, whether you have pride in your culture, having access to cultural activities, knowing who your tribal, clan or language group is. Now, from implementing the scale, we partitioned the sample into two groups, and this was expedient but for the purposes of the study. So we had a strong Indigenous identity group, and we had poorly named weaker Indigenous identity group. But they're the two groups that we divided or partitioned the sample into based on their scores on the identity scale. Now, interestingly, both groups were equally proud to be Indigenous. So every single person scored high on that particular item. However, the major differences between the strong identity group and the weak identity group, there were two. One was that the high identity group were able to identify who their tribal group was, who their language group was or clan, and they had been able to participate in cultural activities. So what we did then, we looked at the impact of identity on a range of outcomes. First of all, we found that if you had a weaker Indigenous identity in prison, you were experiencing significantly higher levels of distress compared to those who had a stronger cultural identity. We also found that having a stronger Indigenous identity meant you had a lot more personal agency, right? So control over your life or perceived control over your life compared to those with a weaker identity. Now, having that personal control, having that agency actually lowered their distress levels as well. So study two found that strong Indigenous identity associated with lower levels of distress, more control over one's life, weaker Indigenous identity associated with higher levels of distress in that custodial environment. Then we had a look at identity and recidivism. So if we just look at point two there, first of all, we found that just identity alone had no impact on recidivism in isolation. So whether you had a strong or weak identity, it made no difference as far as when and how you reoffended. However, we added another variable, which was connection with culture, right? And so this variable was described as sustaining cultural bonds, being able to express your identity, and actually feeling connected to it. So we thought that was different to identity because you could have a strong identity with a cultural group but not necessarily have the means to participate in it and therefore establish a connection. Now what we found here, so if you had a stronger Indigenous identity and you were culturally connected in custody, then that led to a significant less likelihood of violently reoffending on release. Now, this finding didn't actually hold for the weaker identity group. So for whatever reason, their cultural connections may have had less of an impact on recidivism, and it may have, their situation meant prevention or precluding of developing a meaningful connection, perhaps. Now, this is a key finding for custodial treatment. So I guess the question is, so why did the low identify weaker identity group have trouble establishing that connection, or it wasn't meaningful enough to contribute to lowering recidivism? Now, we speculated it could have something to do with cultural efficacy. So this is not perceiving oneself to actually have the resources to express cultural behaviour or even knowing how to. Now, recall that the weaker identity group were less likely to know about their tribal group or have a history of participating in cultural events. Now, that's not particularly unusual because some of the NATSIS surveys have found that, so for example, 5 out of 10 Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people in urban areas do not identify with the tribal group. So it could be that for the lower identity group, just not having the resources to learn about their mob prevented them from having that meaningful connection. It also might be that the lower identifiers have a confused identity. They're not attached to either, the dominant culture or an Indigenous identity. It may be that they had no personal interest in strengthening it as well. It could be that they, perhaps forced to be part of an Aboriginal group in prison, because prison is often partitioned along racial lines. But then I wasn't so sure about that, because every person, as I said in the sample, were equally proud of their Indigenous heritage. So to summarise those three studies, Koori prisoner violent offending was associated with key unmet treatment needs in prison around distress, safety to others, and untreated substance use. But if you were a participant that had a stronger Indigenous identity, your distress levels were lower and you had greater agency. And on top of that, if you were culturally connected as well, you were less likely to commit violence upon release. So these were quite novel findings, and they tell us that, one, the programming appears to be insufficient, at least for treatment needs. And two, that cultural identity and a stronger attachment to it is a prominent protective factor for Indigenous people in custody and requires greater attention. So what are the results telling us? Well, they tell us that culture actually matters in custodial settings quite a lot. Now, this is not an unusual phenomenon. We know that culture shapes every aspect of patient care or client care. Culture very much determines what is normal, what is acceptable, what is typical behaviour, or what is taboo. Culture determines how we communicate. How do we shape our goals? How do we frame our motivations? Culture determines which health model we even ascribe to, right? So is it more of a biomedical model, or is it more of a holistic understanding of health that has a metaphysical domain? Or is it both? And culture determines health expectations, health explanations, and remedies. Culture also determines how we describe our illness, right? So there are cultural idioms of distress. There are illness metaphors, and there are cultural specific symptom reporting styles. Culture determines also how an individual seeks help for health concerns. So family might be their first point of call, for example. Traditional healers may be sought. Opportunity structures in society might preclude some groups from accessing primary health care. Culture also determines how health service providers may respond to a patient or client as well. So do they provide a culturally safe array of practices or treatments, or is it more of a one-size-fits-all situation? So what I'm saying is that culture cannot be ignored in health and legal settings. So what are the results not saying? So you notice, like in the study, we didn't define cultural identity as anything other than the level of importance you might hold to knowing aspects of your culture, your pride in culture, your participation in cultural activities, and your actual knowledge of your cultural group. It's not saying anything more than that, and that was determined because people choose to express or involve themselves in their culture in many different ways. So for some, it's about language, connection to land, customary law. Other people might be happily bicultural and pick and choose what elements they want to ascribe to. Others might prefer their attachment just to be purely nominal or symbolic. Others might prefer to have a greater level of cultural immersion. Right, so but culture is also fluid, and it's not freeze-framed in time, and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders are a very heterogeneous group. Now, what the results are not saying is that a strong identity will necessarily guarantee you good health. right? But clearly, it is one component of holistic care that we should be focusing on. But what we do know from the findings is that it did play a role in limiting distress, and when in combination with a strong cultural connection, it actually limited violence in the sample. So certainly cultural considerations must be a complementary part of rehabilitation, in that it might actually provide enough stress reduction and enough personal agency to participate in or reap the benefits of a rehabilitation plan. Or perhaps culture could actually be the basis for rehabilitation or play a central part in therapy depending on the cultural needs of the client. In fact, the recent Hamburger report, which reviewed the Northern Territory Correctional Services, actually states in its findings that before the young offenders begin to work on their offending, they actually need healing time for reflection, spirituality and connection. So how do we do a better job at meeting the therapeutic needs of Indigenous people in custody? So first we need a therapeutic environment to begin with. Right? So I want to outline some of the pathways forward, and I'll begin at the individual level and then zoom out. So first and foremost, we need to develop as individuals, as healthcare workers, justice officials, correctional officers, medico-legal professionals, etc., a sense of personal cultural safety. Right? And I referred to before the importance of culture in shaping health-seeking behaviours and health service responses. So this means we can no longer ignore cultural relevant information from our processes. Otherwise, we have restrictive processes, right? And this can impact something as simple as cross-cultural interaction between the provider and the client. So what is cultural safety? So to answer that, first I want to start with cultural awareness, right? So cultural awareness is where you learn about the tradition and norms of a different cultural group, right? It's often the stock standard training that's rolled out across organisations, usually in a perfunctory manner, maybe once a year, or maybe just once. Now, it's often described as like visiting a museum, right? You pick up a few protocols and artifacts of a different culture. But the problem with cultural awareness training is that it's very limited and it's actually impractical. And it often serves to render the other group to stereotypes. In many ways, it problematizes the other group. It exoticizes the other group, homogenizes the other group, and actually others the other group. But it also makes us think that that group is actually, you know, the cause of all the communication breakdowns. It has very little bearing on actual practice. Now, this is where cultural safety comes in, right? So cultural safety actually puts the onus on the service provider. It asks the provider, how do our belief systems, our worldviews and biases and prejudices, how do they impact on our interaction with clients? So this entails a process of self-reflection and an understanding of one's own cultural identity and one's own expectations of how your ideas may be imposed on a client from a different culture. So if we have no understanding of our own cultural identity or our own level of ethnocentrism, as everyone has a degree of ethnocentrism, then it becomes all the more difficult to acknowledge the lens through which you view other people. Now, cultural safety also expects clinicians to be aware of the structural causes of disadvantage, right, and how unequal power imbalances may impact health-seeking and law-breaking behaviours. Cultural safety can also help clinicians better identify racism as well when it emerges, and acknowledging the impact this might have on the lives of their clients. So I quite often get asked advice from clinicians when they're writing up reports about multicultural clients that they might have, minority clients, and a lot of it is around racism. And so a common question I get is, I've got this client who says they're experiencing a lot of racism, whether it's from law enforcement or other authorities, but I noticed in the dialogue that that the police didn't actually use a racial epithet. So I think the client's being a little oversensitive or a bit hypervigilant here. And so then I'll say to them, well, it doesn't actually have to be a racial epithet necessarily to be racism. And so for example, I'll use an example of when I was younger and I was driving home, and I'd sometimes drive through an affluent area to get home, and I'd get pulled over, and the police officer wouldn't see me, would say, oh, so what are you doing here? Why are you here? Why are you in this area? So yes, there was no racial epithet delivered to me at all, but there's an underlying sentiment that is perhaps discriminatory. So cultural safety here can help here as it implores clinicians or providers to interrogate their own frames of reference, to interrogate their own privilege that they might have. Now, cultural safety can be measured as well, and it's usually through the experiences of the minority clients themselves. So did they feel that they received treatment in a way where they felt that their cultural background wasn't actually demeaned in the process. And and that's regardless of, you know, how, you know, what culture they follow or how assimilated they are. Now, I also want to talk about some of the hindrances, right, that can preclude an individual transforming into a culturally safe worker. So, first of all, colorblindness, right? So this is the notion that we treat everybody the same, right? The cultural differences don't matter, they shouldn't matter, we treat everyone the same, we're all humans, right? Now, this mentality is widespread, and it's often held by well-meaning people, right? But it does serve to ignore disparities. It also ignores people's social realities and their own lived experiences. It also leads to blaming individuals for their group's disparities. It also ignores how the mainstream cultural status quo could actually prompt the disparities. The obvious point here also is if we're colorblind and, you know, we're not acknowledging any cultural differences and we're all the same, then which cultural norms are we utilizing then in that case? It probably means that we're falling back on a monocultural standard. So you've heard the line, I'm not racist, I don't care if you're black, brown, blue, green, you know that line. It's actually false because nobody treats everyone the same, whether it's in their social life or in their working life. So for example, as a clinician, if you've got three different patients, could be an elderly woman, could be a young boy or someone with cognitive impairment, you want the same, you want equitable outcomes for all three, but you're gonna have to approach that situation differently. You can't treat them all the same because you're gonna offend somebody and some people might have different needs. So you need to approach that clinical encounter differently if you want to have equitable outcomes for all three people. Many people of colour will also tell you how their race or cultural background has influenced so many of their daily interactions. It's inescapable. And there's an abundance of research now, and most of you would be aware of differential hiring practices based on the assumed culture on someone's CV or prejudice in the housing market. So colorblindness is something I think firstly is kind of false, it's unattainable, but when there's an attempt to do it, it's actually very bad for meeting the needs of diverse clients. I also want to talk about microaggressions as well, because these are absolutely widespread. Now these are everyday, subtle, verbal, non-verbal put-downs or indignities directed at, I guess, minority groups or women. They're often automatic, they're often unconscious, and once again, they're usually delivered by well-meaning people. Now this can be as innocuous as a dismissive look or a gesture, like my example with the police officer that I mentioned before. Now other examples of microaggressions are as such. So for example, saying to a person of colour born in Australia, you speak really excellent English. Or telling an Aboriginal person that they're too white to look Aboriginal. Telling a person of colour that they're really articulate, you know, and you emphasise that. Or assuming that non-white Australians must all have been born elsewhere, implying that they're a foreigner. Or for example, if you're a high-achieving Aboriginal person being told, oh, you're all right, you're not like the others, or you know, you're a credit to your race, or did you get into university through some kind of special scheme or through affirmative action? So they're all examples. Actually, that reminds me, when I was in the US, I got delivered the mother of all microaggressions by someone who was a friend of mine that I'd known for quite a while. And I remember my dad flew over from Australia to see me, and my dad's white. And so when I introduced him to my dad, they sort of looked at my dad, then they looked at me, and I was about to open their mouth, and I thought, oh, here we go, here comes a microaggression. But I wasn't prepared for the severity of it. They looked at him and said, oh, your dad's white. And I said, yeah. And they said, oh, that explains it. I said, explains what? They said, oh, you're very well spoken, you know, you're very well educated. And they said it in a matter of fact way. You know, I don't think they thought they were being offensive. They thought they were actually giving me a compliment. So that's a typical example of a microaggression. And they're actually quite pervasive. But they're also very common in the justice system. They're common, in health scenarios. And I've seen a lot of microaggressive language as well in just mental health reports for Aboriginal clients. For example, or psychologist notes sort of questioning their Aboriginality. It's actually quite pervasive. So colorblindness, microaggressions, these are a scourge on effective cross-cultural therapeutic relationships. So as health workers, justice officials, we can't go around saying, oh, I don't see race, you know, I don't see your cultural background when I treat you, I treat everyone the same. Because A, we don't treat everyone the same, same is very subjective. And B, in saying such a comment, we actually delegitimize that person's lived experience. So the key here also is from an individual perspective, is humility and questioning yourself, right? Self-reflection. Am I a culturally safe worker, right? Am I informed enough to understand broader socio-historical factors that undergird client profiles and issues, such as, for example, in intergenerational trauma, impact of child removal, dealing with clients who have a conflicted identity? You know, do I have the ability to deal with these issues as a service provider? Does my organisation provide me with the skill set to even address these issues? Does the program I run address Indigenous cultural needs? Do we even know what Indigenous cultural needs are? Do Indigenous client profiles, which are commonly multifaceted, operating at the individual, family, community, cultural and historical levels, do these needs actually fit neatly into existing correctional programs? And how do we know if they don't? Have our programs undergone local Indigenous peer review? And if an Indigenous prisoner or client refuses to partake or cooperate or benefit from my program, then what are we doing wrong? Am I familiar with the cultural idioms of distress and culturally bound symptom expressions? Am I pathologizing something that might be culturally normative? Do I understand my client's experiences of racism, whether it's institutional or interpersonal? How does my culture and my beliefs impact my client's ability to share personal information with me, or mistrust me, or withhold information from me? How is it affecting their ability to adhere to the treatment that I prescribe them? How is it hindering their ability to comply or cooperate in a prison environment? So if we don't ask those questions, or we don't comfortably acknowledge our limitations here, or we don't even bother to work on ways to acquire these skills, then we're not culturally safe service providers. And this does become an unjust situation for Aboriginal clients. It's also bad from a practical position, right? Because we need to draw from as many sources as possible to improve client care and outcomes. Well, that's just common sense. And now there are a lot of people in this area working hard to provide better outcomes for clients. And it's important that we do maintain those efforts, right? But at the same time, to think critically about the training and the methods we use as well. Okay, so what can we do, I guess, from an organisational perspective? What are some of the therapeutic options worth considering within Justice Health? Now, bear in mind, several of these are already in operation in various forms, though sadly incomplete a lot of the time or just under-resourced. So culturally safe organisations. Prisons, as I've shown, do provide an opportunity to address health concerns for Indigenous clientele. Now, research has actually shown that for Indigenous people who are actually in custody, they're more likely to access healthcare in custody than they are in the community. Right? So this underscores the need for correctional services to actually be culturally safe. We can't have a narrow range of views at the top or an excessive focus on one belief system or practices. Right? So, you know, do we have an organisation that actually asks whether other standards exist? Do we have Indigenous people involved in executive decision making? So when you have diverse views, at the centre of correctional and health service delivery, you'll actually get more relevant service provision. We've seen that occur to some extent in New Zealand, where cultural safety has been legislatively embedded in health service delivery for some time now. So we do need a top-down commitment from an institution or department to cultural safety. And management styles must reflect the importance of cross-cultural service provision. Organisations should also focus on client strengths and not operate under a deficit model of health. Organisations must ensure that they have the resources to meet client diversity, the resources to both hire and then continue to train staff to ensure that they have the cultural skills to deliver cultural safety. And by staff, I mean all staff, including the executive. So it's important to ensure that the institution is committed to cultural safety. And this allows for better individual development for the staff, to remind them of cultural safety protocols, to remind them to avoid colourblindness and microaggressions, but it also enables them to pick up health concerns as well that often go undiagnosed among Indigenous people in custody. We also don't want institutions that push a real sort of strict line of cultural conformity either, right? Because this is going to quickly alienate many people. We absolutely cannot have an unwritten motive of, and I did get a sentiment of this in the US in some areas, that you either assimilate your way to good health or you stay culturally attached and suffer, right? That dichotomy can't happen. And so it's about understanding that client groups have different needs, understanding that cultural conflict is actually inevitable as well, but having the structures in place and having the qualified staff prepared to address any cross-cultural issues that will inevitably arise. This is much better than being reactionary or resorting to punitive tactics or discovering that this is only a problem that needs attention after a royal commission. I guess in the process, we also want to avoid sort of tokenism or shallow attempts at addressing this or disingenuity. And I've seen this quite a lot. And this could mean sort of superficially or clumsily attaching pieces of Aboriginal culture to a Western-based program to make it sound more attractive to Aboriginal clients, or cosmetically giving the appearance that it's culturally safe when it was not actually developed at all from an Aboriginal perspective. I also want to sort of mention reconciliation action plans, which have a good general motive, but sometimes they're disingenuous too. So you might have noticed the increase in reconciliation action plans over the past decade from various organisations. So they're often launched with much fanfare and excitement, but unfortunately a lot of them disappear into the abyss after 2 to 3 years without any idea as to whether the goals were met or even looked at over time. And the language in them is ambitious, which can be good, but they're very rarely audited, right? So I feel like if we're going to continue to have reconciliation action plans from organisations, then they need to be implemented widely, be attached to performance indicators, and perhaps independently overseen by an appropriate advisory body as well. Okay, so I think a stronger emphasis on through care is absolutely vital, right? So we could have the best design prison programs available in a hypothetically culturally safe organisation, but we might not see that impact sustained if there is no appropriate through care on release. So through care is the coordinated service provision that supports a client from their time in prison to when they're resettled back into the community. Now, this whole idea is about continuity of care. It's about engaging people in programs in prison, planning for release, having supports on the outside to facilitate that transition, and sustaining on building on any progress that may have been developed inside, or just being able to get through that parole period. And we don't want to undo any therapeutic work made in a hypothetically culturally safe prison by sending someone back to a criminogenic environment with absolutely zero supports. So therefore, we need to consider both reintegration and rehabilitation. And for complex needs offenders, one can't work without the other. You need both. So for example, if one's basic life needs are not in order, then it's unlikely that they're either going to make the most of their treatment or even access it. On the other hand, if someone is actually accessing treatment and making it to treatment, but their basic life needs are not, or reintegrative life needs are not met, then they'll at some point go back into survival mode and probably lead them back to the criminal justice system and they won't finish their treatment, particularly if they're under onerous parole conditions. So through care can help, and supports may include accommodation, treatment, connection with primary health care services, reconnection with family, developing personal life skills, etc. And this is so important because transition from prison back into the community, this is probably the highest risk time for reoffending and also mortality as well. Unfortunately, these services for Indigenous clients, and there are services around, these are chronically underfunded, despite the very important service role they provide. There are a lot of good services in this space around the country, but this area requires serious attention and better funding if we are wanting to reduce Indigenous incarceration. Also want to mention judicial monitoring. So judicial monitoring is informed by the field of therapeutic jurisprudence. And this is where the law is administered as a therapeutic agent. So here an offender can appear before the magistrate several times while their progress, sort of engaging in rehabilitative programs and other life improvement goals, are carefully monitored by the magistrate, whose role is to encourage and motivate behavioural change. Now this process is less punitive, it's non-adversarial, and allows offenders to actually own their negotiated goals whilst being held accountable. Now, these problem-solving courts tend to be tailored to those with complex needs, mental health, substance abuse issues, and the socially and culturally disadvantaged. So in Victoria, circle sentencing for Indigenous clients falls under judicial monitoring. So in the Koori courts in Victoria, magistrates do have the ability to defer sentencing to enable the client to engage in rehabilitation programs and cultural services. And here the court will maintain contact with the client during this period, providing cultural support until they return for sentencing. Also want to mention Gladue reports, and I think they're gaining some traction in some parts of the country. So Gladue reports, they're from Canada. So under the Canadian Criminal Code, judges are expected to consider the unique issues that contextualise Aboriginal offending in sentencing. So here the decreasing use of incarceration is emphasised, and all other available sanctions, other than imprisonment, that are reasonable in the circumstances, of course, are to be considered. Now, these are called the Gladue principles. Now, as part of the Gladue principles, judges are expected to call for a Gladue report. Now, this is a pre-sentence report written by an Aboriginal caseworker that includes all the facts relevant to the client's Aboriginality and options for healing as well. Now, the aim of a Gladue report is to provide the judge with a much deeper understanding of the social circumstances of the Aboriginal offending, so contextualises the offending. Some of the issues included in a Gladue report include the following, and I've changed the wording to suit Australian conditions. So it might ask, for example, is the client a member of the Stolen Generations? Did they experience childhood, or are they experiencing current poverty? Have they or do they have had access to culturally relevant or healing resources? Have they been dislocated from an Aboriginal community, or including the loss of their identity, culture and ancestral knowledge? Is drug abuse or alcohol use, is it common in the community that they're from? Do they have family members that were part of the Stolen Generations? Were they in foster care? Were they removed from their family as a child? And if so, was it with non-Aboriginal carers? Have they had a lack of educational opportunities? Have they experienced racism, overt or covert? What are the social issues affecting the offender's community, and are they being addressed politically? Has there been suicide among friends or family? Do they have a cultural or spiritual support network? Have they witnessed violence? Is there a general lack of resources in the community? And do they have fetal alcohol spectrum disorder or cognitive impairment or learning difficulties? What are their career goals? Do they have a connection to the Aboriginal community and culture? And what are their personal strengths and attributes and significant cultural relationships? So this is very sort of deep, broad and contextualised, culturally unique information. And so based on that information and some of the other health issues that the caseworker might ascertain, the caseworker will then propose interventions and restorative justice options as part of the pre-sentence report. So Gladue reports could actually be quite useful in an Australian context, but as it stands right now within Australian legal frameworks, they don't explicitly refer to the unique circumstances of Aboriginal Australians. Okay, so I also want to mention therapeutic housing options. So in the interest of upholding the Royal Commission to Aboriginal Deaths in Custody recommendation of imprisonment as a last resort, we should start explore alternatives to prison in the form of therapeutic housing, but not just as an alternative to custody, but also as transitional housing, sort of post-release or bail accommodation. Now, Victorian Magistrate Jenny Bowles recently recommended the introduction of youth therapeutic orders, where young people can actually be placed in a therapeutic residential facility instead of going to prison. Now, the idea here is that the youth with complex needs will have access to highly skilled clinical staff around the clock, with a focus on ensuring client well-being and preparation for transition back into the community. So here the underlying issues of youth crime are the focus of these facilities, which are have a commitment to intensive care. Now these issues are, as it stands now, are unlikely to be addressed appropriately in youth prisons. There may be scope here to think about an Indigenous-specific therapeutic residential facilities in line with what the magistrate described, that provide a culturally based service. Similar facilities could be utilised for transitional purposes, as I mentioned earlier. We know that a lot of Indigenous youth are unable to get parole because they've been deemed to not have a responsible carer, for example. So some of these initiatives, I think, are something we need to give further consideration to. Now, I also want to point out that these initiatives also must operate with the safety of those in the community in mind as well. So more sensible rehabilitation initiatives for offenders does not supersede our duty to protect families, women and children from violence. But I do think a therapeutic approach is more likely to address the complex needs of an offender rather than the tough on crime approach, which results in offenders leaving prison in a much poorer state and straight back to the community with little support. It's also often mentioned that therapeutic approaches are too expensive, right? Therapeutic facilities too expensive. But as Dennis Glover, a Melbourne academic, recently remarked, we can either pay for their success or we can pay for their failure. And failure is much more expensive in the long run. We've also got to think about paying correctional staff more. Right, therapeutic approaches do require highly skilled staff. Position in corrections can be poorly paid. And you know, if you you know, a lot of people might not want to work in that particular environment on the low salaries that are offered. And because they can, it can be a very stressful and challenging environment to work in. And I think we're not valuing people in custody, if we're Indigenous people in custody, if we're not attracting the highest quality correctional staff. And we're also not valuing our staff either if we continue to considerably underpay them. Now, I just want to make some final remarks. Now, So this photo was from the USA. This was a newspaper article that myself and my colleague in Nebraska did on, we were looking at how risk instruments tend to over-criminalise Native youth. And this was the photo they took. They put in the newspaper and they put it online. And one of my colleagues saw this and felt that it looked like a very tacky promo for a bad police TV show. And then they superimposed Law and Order Cultural Competence Unit and then decided to disseminate it on social media. So it was kind of funny, and it's sort of apt to what I'm talking about. So just to make some final remarks, Law and Order is, as we know, driven by populism, reactionary politics, and it does lead us to practices like mandatory sentencing and paperless arrests, targeted law enforcement strategies, but also this kind of simultaneous pullback on initiatives that focus on the underlying drivers of crime. I believe we do need prisons. I'm not an abolitionist. There are people whose behaviours have and will put the community at risk. But that doesn't mean that we cannot promote behavioural change in custodial circumstances and during transition that supports the aims of rehabilitation. Now, if we don't, many clients will just pose a far greater risk to the community on release, owing to the punitive conditions and harmful impacts of prison. Now, tough on crime policies also disproportionately impact Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. And some might argue, well, how can the law have this effect? How can a law be biased in and of itself to have that disparate outcome? Well, I would say that the law doesn't operate in a vacuum. So if you implement a so-called neutral law into an unequal situation, it perhaps could sustain or perhaps exacerbate that inequality. And that leads to a question, is a policy racist if it creates a racial disparity? Is it about the intent or is it more about the outcome? But I'll leave that for others to debate. But what I do want to say is that we need to be cautious or have the appropriate foresight into how we introduce a law that might disproportionately impact a group of people or an already socially deprived community which just does not have the resources or social capital to recover from those impacts. And tough on crime policies essentially leaves the justice system to deal with the causes and effects of social problems. But as I've said throughout the presentation, it doesn't mean that we who work in corrections and justice, health and relevant departments shouldn't do everything we can to create a more culturally safe and therapeutic custodial environment. So I'll leave it there, and thanks for your attention.